Good morning, and thank you for joining us today. Here's a quick look at what's going on at the church.
We are still currently raising money for our church building fund. Anything you can donate would be greatly appreciated, and we know that God will bless your generosity.
Corporate prayer takes place each Sunday morning at 10 o'clock in the fellowship hall.
Help yourself to free coffee and sweets in the Welcome Center before service.
If this is your first time here, we would like to say a special thank you for joining us and ask that you fill out our visitor's card and drop it in the offering basket.
We would love to connect with you. Please take a moment to text and save the number on the screen to receive updates about what's going on at the church, as well as a place for you to send prayer requests, connect with a member of the leadership team, and ask any questions you may have.
Holy Communion is available to everyone and may be taken at any time during the service.
Parents, childcare is provided during each service for children newborn to 2 years old.
If you're 3 years old through fifth grade, we would love for you to join us in Faith Kids every Sunday during the service.
We would love for you to join us every Tuesday and Thursday morning for the Call of the Faithful. For more information on how to join, pick up a flyer in the foyer.
This Wednesday is Worship Wednesday at Faith Family Church, starting at 6 o'clock.
Well, good morning and welcome to Faith Family Church. We welcome you for being here. We ask you to join in our praise and worship. It's not a participation sport. I mean, it is participation. It's not an observation. So we invite you to join in. And then as the word comes forward, open our hearts and our minds to receive from the word so that we can be changed. And Debbie was asked to do this, and she was asked to give a testimony, but she's in a nursery this morning. So she asked if I would give a testimony about our grandson, Jordan. And when she first asked me, I felt like, well, this is a little premature because we're in the middle of this. But, you know, God can get glory even in the middle of our situations. And Jordan has an issue with his heart. And one side of his heart is enlarged. There's a hole in the other side. And the doctors are saying that he will need surgery to repair this. He's 4 years old. He's small for his age, and which all of our kids were, so it's nothing new. I'm the biggest in our family, so if that says anything. But we've been through situations like this before. We had it with Christopher. Christopher had a hole in his heart, and with Christopher, it was minor, and the doctors were like, we're just going to monitor this and see what happens. And, you know, there's chances that it could close on its own, which, you know, is still not on its own because God created us, and anything that happens, it's still God. So, you know, that happened 3 years later. Brittany came along. Hers was a little more serious. The doctors run several tests, and every test showed the hole in her heart. And then so we had a meeting with the doctor, and he showed us all three tests and showed us the hole in her heart, played somewhere we could hear. The sounds of the effect of the hole in her heart. So he's like, this one is not one of those that heals itself. This one will require surgery. And he said, so be prepared. He said, just keep an eye on her. He said, she will have heart failure before she's a year old. And not a heart attack, but heart failure. And he said what it means is that the heart will not pump the blood sufficient to sustain her body. And one of the first symptoms you'll see, her lips will start to turn blue. When you see that, bring her in, and we'll do surgery to repair that problem. So we were devastated over that, and we brought her before the church, and they anointed her with oil, and we had family, friends, and don't know who all praying over her. And so we went back for a consultation, and he had some interns that came in, and he had each of them listen, and there were three young interns, and each one listened, and they're like, I don't hear what you're talking about. So all three of them went through. The doctor was getting frustrated. So he took the stethoscope and he put up and he listened and he's like, well, it sounds like it's not as big as it was. And he's like, I think the medicine we're giving her is working. We're like, you didn't give her any medicine. So he went and checked, said, still, this is the kind that doesn't heal itself. We're going to still have to have surgery, so come back in a couple of months. We went back in a couple months later. He's like, the hole's gone. We can't explain it. We don't know what to say. And he said, I can't explain it. And I said, I can't. Well, he looked at me kind of strange, and I told him that we'd been praying. We feel that God healed it. And, you know, he said, well, you don't have to come back. She won't need surgery. Just go on and about your life. So as we went out, we heard him telling the interns, you know, you'll encounter people like this from time to time. And but we just, like, you know, I told God, I said, God, you know, if you heal it, we're gonna give a testimony. We're gonna tell people. And the thing about it, that day, it wasn't just the doctor, there were three interns that came in. And I'm like, well, here you go. Here's the explanation. This is what happened. So you know, Jordan is already a miracle child. Nikki was told she'd never have children. And they got pregnant. They lost their first child, which was devastating to them. And now then, Jordan is the third of their children. So he has the enlarged heart and the hole in his heart, and they're saying surgery. And you know, we've just been talking to Christopher and Nikki and just encouraging them, saying, you know, we've been through this twice already. And even with Brittany, we were like, you know, we're believing for a miracle. But if it comes to the point where she has to have surgery, we're going to believe God touched the doctors, and she'll get her healing that way. So we're feeling the same. We're believing the same thing for Jordan. We just, you know, we don't have fear and anxiety as we had the first time or two. As parents, this is our first time, so I'm sure it's, you know, a little different. But we've just been encouraging them, and we just believe that. God's going to see us through this, and our testimony is a personal. It's not a story that you've repeated that heard somebody else tell. This is what God's doing for and through in your life, God intervening in on our behalf, and I just want to give God praise. Lord, and I believe that we're still believing for a miracle, but we're believing for healing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Glory to God. What an amazing testimony, and Terry's right. You know, people can try to talk you out of what the Word says, and they will. And the enemy will even try to talk you out of the Word of God, even if you have studied that Word and memorized that Word. But when you have a testimony, you have lived through it, there's no talking you out of that. So this morning, I just want to open with prayer. I just want to pray this morning. We just lift up Jordan this morning, Father God. We lift him up to you. He's already a miracle that he's here, but we're believing for supernatural manifestation of your word. You said you sent your word and healed them and delivered them from all of their destruction. So, Father God, where the enemy would come in and try to bring destruction in Jordan's life and Nikki and Chris and Logan and Emerson's life, Father God, we lift up that family, Father God, and we we say, according to your word, you said, am I a man that I would lie? Have I not said it? Will I not do it? And Lord, the testimony of Jesus is the prophecy that we prophesy what you've already done. You will do it again. And we're believing with the Oswalds, Father God, you will do it again, Father God. And we give you the praise and the glory. We thank you right now. Like Terry said, in the middle of what we're going through, we're not going to wait to receive it and then say, oh, thank you, we received it. No, we receive it right now, because your word says when we pray, if we pray according to your word, then we know that you hear us and that we have the petitions of what we pray. And so we're praying according to your word. And you said, I am the Lord God that healeth thee. And so, Father God, we thank you for what you're doing in Jordan's life right now, that you're making that heart where it's enlarged get to the shape and the size that it needs to be to function the way that you created it. And Father God, he may be a little bit small right now, but Father God, that he's going to be accelerate in his growth and be where he needs to be. And I say, whole close up, whole in that heart, you close up according to the word, that everything else is subject to change, but your word is forever settled. And so we thank you right now. Can you just give the Lord a hand clap? Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. And Lord, we welcome your presence into this place. God, I thank you for being here. I know you're here because you said, would two agree, that two will come together in my name, that I am in the midst, which means he's right here with us. And we welcome you. We just say, just like if you came to my house, I would open the door and say, welcome, come in, have a seat, make yourself at home. And that's what we want. We want that of the Lord. We say, this is your place. This is your house. And we want you to know that first and foremost, Holy Spirit, you're welcome to have your way in each one of our lives. Do what you want to do. Do what you want to do. Can you just tell the Lord? Can you say it with your words this morning? Lord, I'm here for you. Do what you want to do in my life. I don't want to leave the same way I came. I may have come in up on the mountains today, but God, your word says come up a little higher. And so God, we desire, Father God, just to have that God encounter today. Lord, our life is to worship you. May our life bring you glory and honor. And Lord, we just thank you. I'm just so excited to be in your presence today. How exciting, Father God, to be with your people, to be in this place. And I know, Father God, that you're going to move. You're going to change lives today. And so we thank you. I just thank you right now, Lord. I just thank you, thank you, thank you for being here. Thank you, Lord, that we welcome you and you show up. Father God, it's just not another weekly thing that we check off our list that we do, but we come in this place and you show up and then you show out and you move mightily. And I just thank you, Father God. Let us always be grateful. Let us always, Father God, in the last days it says that there will be an ungrateful generation, not here. I declare that Faith Family Church is a body of believers that are grateful. We look when things come our way, and like Deb Terrier is saying, we're going to thank him right now. We're going to praise him right now. You may be in the middle of something right now. You want to get out of it? If you want to get out of it, start thanking him. Start thanking him for bringing deliverance. Start thanking him for meeting your needs. Start thanking him right now for healing you. Well, I don't feel like I'm healed. Don't go by your feelings. Don't go by your feelings. Go by the word of God, because it never changes. It never changes. So Lord, we welcome you. Lord, I thank you for the ones that give tithe and offering, and they're faithful, and the ones that have given over and above. Lord, you know the need we have with the air conditioners. And God, we're believing we have like $4,500 of the $20,000 that we need. And so, God, I thank you. I thank you for that, Lord God. I thank you that money's coming in, that you are the Lord God that provides. And I give you the praise and the glory, because if people are giving, you're giving to them to give. And so you're blessing them so they can be a blessing. And so, Father God, just pour it out on your people. Pour it out on your people. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. Glory to God. Glory to God. And bless this team behind me. Just give the praise and worship team a hand clap, if you will, this morning. They come out early. They meet during the week, and they minister, and they prepare to bring you into the presence of the Lord. So, Lord, we just thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. I just want you to get outside of your comfort zone this morning. Forget who's around you. Don't worry about that. The one that's around you that counts the most, the Lord God Almighty. and just pour out of your heart this morning how much you love him, how much you appreciate him, what he means to you. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. God, you're so good. Can you just tell him what he means to you before we even start worshiping in song? God, just what you're so good. You're so good. You're so good. You're so good. Dustin, will you bring the family that suffered a loss this morning? I just feel impressed to bring him down. And if I can get some of the church body, some of our kids in kids' church suffered a loss this week. And I just want you to, as a body, come pray for them and love on them. Let them know they're just not Dustin's kids. They're our kids. That they're part of this church, and they're hurting. And so we're hurting. So can you just come up and love on them this morning and lift them up? Glory to God. Glory to God. I just thank you, God, that you're ever mindful of every need that we have. And I just pray for Julie and Fergie and Junior and the twins and the family, Father God. They're going to face things, Father God, that at this age they shouldn't be facing. But God, you're with them. You haven't forgot them. You are with them and you love them. And so, Father God, I just pray you give them supernatural peace. Supernatural peace that goes far beyond what we can even understand. Father God, keep them covered. Cover them, Lord God. Holy Spirit, I just ask that you love on them in ways that we can't even love on them. But God, you touch their hearts, Father God. When they feel like they're alone and they don't know the answers, God, you are the answer. God, just love on them this morning, Father God. Where it seems to be no hope, that you are hope, that you are what you say you are. You said, I am a friend that sticks closer than a brother, that you are. You said, I am that I am. And so you are what they need right now, Father God. I just thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. I thank you, Father God, that you're going to keep them covered in the coming days, Lord God. God, the questions that they have, that they'll hear you speak to them as they cry out to you, Lord, that you're there with them. Your presence is with them, that they don't feel alone, Father God, but they feel the presence of God on their lives, Lord God. I just thank you, Lord. I thank you for each one of them, and I thank you for what you're doing. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. And if you will, continue to lift up this family. They lost, these young people lost their mother this week. And if you'll just continue to be praying for them and reach out to them. And we're just going to keep loving and believing that God. Dustin, you got something to say? Okay, I'm going to hug y'all and then we'll worship. Glory to God.
After all that I've done, you're still here with me. And what kind of father would take me as I am? You don't care where I've been, just that I'm here with you. With love's arms around me, I'm finally home. There's no better feeling than being known. Always good and always kind, this is what my father's like. What kind of father would give his only son?
Savior's robe as he walked into the room Where people pray, where we hear praises, he hears faith. There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's robe as he walks into the room. Where people pray, where we hear worship, he hears faith. Oh. Oh. Awake my soul and sing, sing his praise aloud, sing his praise. Awake my soul and sing, sing his praise aloud, sing his praise His praise aloud. Sing His praise aloud. Oh, awake my soul and sing. Sing His praise aloud. Sing His praise
people. Yeah. Some of y'all know my story. I was addicted to drugs for years. I don't know how many years, 8 years, 10 years, whatever, intravenously, whatever. I've done it all. And I had experience even before I was saved, what the Bible would call a trance or an open vision. I've only had one of these really in my life, never had them again. And I was sitting in my room and I was sober. I was like, I'm gonna quit doing drugs, but man, it was hard. And as I'm sitting in bed, the ceiling disappears in my bedroom. And I see like clouds rolling. I saw like, and I remember thinking clouds rolling. I saw it looked like an angel with a horn, and it blew the horn. And my mom was a Christian. She told me, she used to tell me like, Jesus coming back for his church one day. You better be ready, that kind of stuff, you know? And I wasn't saved anything. I didn't really believe in that stuff. But at that moment, I knew it was true. And I remember saying like, oh no, I'm going to hell. She was right. But all of a sudden, a feeling hit me, that was so intense. I remember I began to like, I wasn't floating, but I began to come out of my bed, like my upper body, and my hands just went in the air, and I just wept for 10 whole minutes. And I felt the best feeling I've ever felt in my life. It was a feeling I couldn't put into words to until the first song we sang a while ago, and it just hit me. The first song we sang, it talking about like his presence being our home. I felt at home for the first time in my life in his presence. Couldn't explain it then. I didn't know what was going on. And has anybody ever suffered addiction with alcohol and drugs? You feel like a wanderer, like you never belong. And at that moment, I felt like I'm where I felt whole. I felt complete. You see, I outside of context to this and in here, I do a lot of deliverance and inner healing and a lot of stuff like that. And I have a lot of models and things that I use. But all them models are meant to do is to get Jesus to your brokenness. To get his presence to your brokenness. Because I can't fix anything. But we get his presence to the places in your life where you need to feel at home. That you're not a wanderer anymore. That there's a place for you at his table. Me and Pastor Terry had a text conversation yesterday about his presence and talking about like this church and, you know, the leadership of here. We're not trying to lead you to us because we can't fix you. We're trying to lead you to the one who's going to make you feel at home. We're trying to form an atmosphere and a place where you walk in this building, you say, God's here. And I hope I'm speaking for Steve and everybody else. Not everything's going to be professional all the time. It's going to be a little different. We don't care. We just want you to experience God. We don't want you coming in and say, man, he's a great preacher. He's a great exhorter. That's great worship. Although we want all the things to be good. We want you to feel at home in his presence. We want to cultivate a place where you feel at home with him. That's why we're here. There's a few reasons why we come to church. One is to be encouraged by one another, right? The other one is so we're being equipped for the work of the ministry. But one of the main things we come here for is as corporately, we build a dwelling place of him, of God in the spirit. When we're coming together and it says, my people are together, I'm coming to visit them and to host his presence well. When's the last time you felt that feeling of being home? Are you too busy? Are you too distracted? Are you too... And some of us, we don't know. We don't even know what that means, and that's okay. But it's the pursuit of this thing. Let your one thing be, I want to know God. When I say God, I mean Father, Son, Holy Spirit. I want to know God. I want to know him. There's times in my prayer closet where I think I just spent an hour wasting my time, but I know I didn't. It's a pursuit, guys, an everyday pursuit. I can care less about a lot of things. I'm glad God blesses me. I'm glad he does a lot of amazing things in my life. But the thing I thank him for is the most is, man, I could be with him. There's times where I need him, guys, and I go to my prayer closet, and his presence comes. I'm like, this is all I really need. This is my refuge. The Bible doesn't promise that he's going to give you refuge. The promise is, I am your refuge. He's your hiding place. He wants you to hide in him. I don't want to go any longer. Steve, you can come up. Yeah, I'll preach up. But anyway, I just want you to let this be the one thing. And that's my heart's desire. That's our heart's desire. Me and him didn't talk about this, but let it be your one thing, your one desire. Do you know him? And if you don't, do you want to know him? There's times I've been walking with Jesus, spending hours a day with the Lord, and sometimes, God, I still don't know you. And that's okay. That's a good thing. Because he's vast. You're never going to know all of him. But make it in your heart, let it, your heart pursuit be, I want to know him.
Amen. I couldn't agree more with what he just said. It's so interesting because, yeah, y'all can have a seat. And no one ever told y'all to sit or stand or, yeah, just whatever. This is what we mean by the professionalism thing. It's funny because, and Chris, if we get the house lights on. But it's funny because, so for a while in my life, what I did for a living was like production stuff. I did that for a decent amount of time in my life. And like, so that desire for professionalism very much is like something I have. And yet, like, it's so true what Dustin just said. Like, in this place, as much as I want things to go well and go right, I care way more about his presence being here than I do if everything goes perfectly. Because, like, I've been to some like amazing concerts. I've helped put amazing concerts on where like the show went off without a hitch. There wasn't a problem in it, but I didn't feel the Holy Spirit. And like, it's a great experience. It's a great time, but you leave that place and you're the same as you were before you went. And those memories fade, and the thing that you got to do and see fades. But the Holy Spirit and his presence in your life and what he is able to do when you give him any part of you and you allow him to come in and to take up residence in your life, it's life-changing. And there's no going back. It's something different. So today has been an interesting day. To say the least, I'm always keenly aware of the fact that God knows way more than I do. I know I've told you before, he's smarter than me, he's more clever than I am, he's smarter than you, he's more clever than you are. I don't know how many of y'all believe that. Some of you may think that you're pretty smart or pretty clever, but he is. He's both better than you. But this morning has been just like, man, it's so crazy the way that God works. So, we are going to get into the Word of God today. Are y'all excited? Yeah. It's going to be a good day. I'm really pumped. Today is going to be a little bit different, though. Not because we're changing the series, because the series lives on. So, we have been doing, we're still doing, you quote it, but do you know it? Been going for a while now, still going strong. A buddy of mine texted me yesterday and said, because I'd posted on Facebook that we were continuing, and he texted me and he was like, oh, it's still going, I'm so excited. I was like, yeah, it may go for a few more weeks, because this week he gave me like, I texted him yesterday, but this week he gave me like three more, so we'll see how long this thing goes. I have no idea. But today is going to be different because we are going to talk about a scripture that is frequently quoted, but I would say 99.9% of the time that it's quoted incorrectly. It's not quoted, like, the verse that people quote, the thing that people says, those words don't exist in the Bible. Which is weird, right? So then you have to ask yourself, like, what are you quoting? So the words don't exist in the Bible. So I could tell you the reference, but probably most of you, unless you just happen to know this passage, wouldn't know this scripture. And what's weird about it is when God gave this to me and said, this is what we're talking about this week, I was like, great, because it was on my list. It was something I had had. And then I was like, all right, cool. Like, I'll find that scripture. And then I couldn't find the scripture. And I'm like, why can't I find this scripture? And he said, because you're not quoting it correctly. And I was like, oh, all right. So then I had to find the scripture that people reference when they quote this scripture. All right, so I'll give you the address, but if no one knows it, don't beat yourselves up. Okay, so the address is Psalm 22:3. Psalm 22:3. Okay, I didn't expect. So what we say when we quote this is that he or God, people depending on the context, inhabits the praises of his people. How many of you have heard that before? He inhabits the praises of his people. The Bible does not say that. Did y'all know that? You've heard it before, right? How many of y'all have heard that before? God inhabits the praises of his people. But the Bible doesn't say that. That's not what it says. So, the other thing that we're going to do interesting today is I typically read out of the NIV, but we're going to read four translations today. Whew, I know that's a lot. For Psalm 22:3, because I want y'all to see how we get there. How do we get this scripture? Why are people saying he inhabits the praises of his people if that scripture doesn't exist? But I want to show you why people say it that way. So in the King James Version, Psalm 22:3, it says, "But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel." Do y'all see that? "But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel." So you can see where we make the leap. He inhabits the praises of his people, right? Israel is his people. He inhabits the praises of Israel. So we say he inhabits the praise of his people. In the World English Bible, or World English Bible Translation, Psalm 22:3 says, "But you are holy, you who inhabit the praises of Israel." So this just takes out the thees and thous and the word inhabitest, which is a lot of fun to say. I don't know why we don't talk like that anymore. "You who inhabit the praises of Israel." In the NIV, which is the version that I typically read out of, it says, "Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the one Israel praises." In the New Living Translation, "Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel." Do y'all see that? So maybe you've heard the scripture quoted not as he inhabits the praises of his people, but that he is enthroned on the praises of his people. How many of you ever heard that one? Okay, he is enthroned on the praises of his people. The Bible doesn't say that either. Okay, this is what it actually says. We quote it, but we're alluding to it. We know that the gist of the verse, but that is what the verse actually says. Okay, so how many of y'all have heard this before? One of the two. He inhabits the praise of his people. He's enthroned upon the praise of the people. One of the two. Great. Okay. So I want to talk to you about this today, because what is it that we're saying when we say this? Pay attention to these words, okay? The words of the actual scriptures matter. Again, out of the World English Bible, "But you are holy, you who inhabit the praises of Israel," NIV, "Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One, you are the one Israel praises, yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel." What are we saying? When people quote that, what are they saying? He inhabits the praises of his people. That means, what does it mean to inhabit? To dwell, to live in the praises of his people, of Israel, right? This is what the writer says in Psalm. You inhabit the praise of your people. How many of you have ever been in a situation and you have felt completely alone and abandoned. Just a couple of us? Not most of us aren't that way? Okay. Oh, now we're getting head nods. Okay. So people just, you don't want to do the hand raise today. All right, I'll stop asking questions. All right. You have, I'm sure, in your life been at a place where you were facing something and you felt alone and abandoned. The scripture says that God inhabits the praise of his people. He dwells in the praise of his people. He exists in the praise of his people. He can be found in the praise of his people. Which means what? If I am looking for God, if I am at a place where I feel alone, where I feel abandoned, where I feel like nobody's around, where I feel completely and totally isolated, and I need a friend, how do I get a friend to show up? I call out his name. When I begin to praise him, he shows up. He literally exists within my praise. So when I begin to praise, he arrives. Isn't that great? Like, is that not the best news? If I will praise him, he will show up. He will arrive. So what is it to praise him? To praise him is to exalt him, to magnify him, to glorify him. I begin to talk about him. I begin to talk about all that he has done, all that he can do, all of his promises. I begin to stand on his word. I begin to put him into the center, into the forefront of everything in my life. When I do that, it says he shows up. That's great news. Isn't that amazing? Yep. Like, how many of you ever, well, I'm not going to ask a question because you don't like raising your hands this morning. I'm sure you've probably at some point in your life been in a situation where you've been going through something and you could have used a hand. And you've probably reached out to people that you know, maybe a friend, maybe a family member, a loved one, somebody. And unfortunately, on that particular day, that person or those people that you reached out to said, hey, I wish I could help, but I am unavailable. But the God of all the universe, the creator of everything we know, the one who breathes out stars, this God says, if you begin to proclaim my name, if you begin to exalt me, if you begin to magnify me, if you begin to glorify me, if you begin to praise me, I will come to you. This isn't a, hey, I hope that you can come. Well, let me check my calendar. No, no, no. You start praising and he shows up and he's there. He inhabits the praises of his people. Inhabits is an interesting word. To live in, to dwell, as Miss Mary said. Like, what do we call this place? This is a church, right? Okay, what are other names that we say for churches? We call it the house of the Lord, right? We have a scripture out here over our door when you come in. I was glad when they said, let us go into the house of the Lord, right? I'm not going to ask a question because y'all aren't raising hands today, but I'm sure most of you live in a house. I would imagine most of you have a house, some kind of dwelling place, right? If you've ever moved into a brand new house, when you first moved in, it probably didn't feel like anything other than a building. It probably didn't feel like anything other than a structure when you first moved in. If you moved in, especially if the place was like unfurnished, it's just walls and flooring and the ceiling and maybe a window here or there, door, like there ain't nothing special about it. But what do we do in our houses? We begin to fill them with the things that we like. We begin to fill them with things that are reflections of us. Are you with me? What does that do to our house? It's making our house into our home. The place that we want to dwell, the place that we desire to reside. Are you with me? Okay. Back in 2020, we were having a worship service here at the church. And I don't remember who all was here on that particular day. I do know Dustin was there, because I remember Dustin in particular being there. But I only remember that because he and I had an interaction up here.
But as we were worshiping, like the glory of God fell in this place and the presence was like, it was unbelievably like real, tangible, like power. I mean, it was in the room. It was crazy. And God said something to me at that time in 2020. And I was so excited and I thought it was awesome. And for several years now, I had carried that word around. And what he said to me, I was right here on the floor, walking, pacing back and forth. His music was playing, worship was going on. And God said, "Thank you for making my house my home." That's what he told me. "Thank you for making my house my home." And he was talking about the fact that we were worshiping the way that we were in here. And so that was 2020. It's now 2024. 4 years ago. I remember too that that was prior to mom and dad coming back from being gone when he, so what it was like spring of 2020, okay? "Thank you for making my house my home." That's a great word. Do you know, and as Dustin just said a minute ago about texting, do you know that we have had multiple people who have come to our church since that time? Our church has grown, things are going well. We have had multiple people come in and tell us, visitors, first time coming, first week coming, sometimes it's a couple weeks in, but they tell us, one of the things that they say all the time to the leadership here is, it is amazing to experience the presence of God in this church. That they can actually experience, that they can feel it, it's different. The way they feel when they walk in, it's different. Do you know why? Because we've made his house his home. His presence is here because this has been a place of praise and he inhabits the place of praise. In the same way that I inhabit a house and I bring what I like into it, when he inhabits my praise, when I am in a place in my life where I begin to praise him, he shows up, but he doesn't come empty-handed. He brings things that he likes with him because it's his house. It's the place he inhabits. Are you with me? So what happens when I need things in my life and I begin to praise him? He comes with the answer. So this isn't a, he's going to show up, but then what? I begin to praise him in the midst of what I'm going through. And when he arrives, he doesn't come empty-handed. He comes with the thing that is the answer to my need. This is what he does. This is what it is to dwell in the praises of his people. When he shows up, he brings things. Are you with me? Okay, so this is incredible. This is great news, okay? But I want you, first of all, before we move on to the next thing. So that is to inhabit, right? In the NIV translation, the NLT translation, some other translations as well, they say that he is enthroned. Right? Which to me is like a whole other side of this thing. Because it's one thing to live in a place, it's another thing to be the king of that place, the ruler of that place, the lord of that place. Yep. Right? Those are two different things. This isn't him showing up and he's just like, "Cool, I'm at my house now." No, no, no. He is showing up and he is in control. This is him showing up, and he has power to actually get things done. This is him showing up with authority. Are you with me? This is not just him coming to hang out with you, although there are times in our lives where we just need a friend. But this is him coming, and he actually has the power to do things, to accomplish things, because he is enthroned on our praise. But what we do, but listen to this. This is insane. We are praising him, and he is enthroned on our praise. Are you with me? Which means what? I have the power to place him on the throne in my life. I have the authority to decide whether or not he is going to be effective in my life, whether he's going to have any authority in my life, whether or not he can rule in my life, in my situation. I get that choice. We think about this in terms of us giving him our lives in the beginning at salvation, but in every situation, I get to determine whether or not He is king over me in my life. Now, the Bible says that one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. I know that to be true. So whether you want to or you don't want to, one day it's going to happen. But every day and in every situation, I can decide, I get to choose if I allow him to rule in my life. Every day in every situation. The question becomes, how do I make that decision? What does it look like to make that kind of determination? If you have your Bibles and you're in the book of Psalm 22, the book of Psalm chapter 22, I want us to read this chapter really quickly. It's not super long. It won't take a long time. And I am almost done. There's a couple more points I want to make and then I'm done. Look at the beginning, verse 1. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me? So far from my cries of anguish. My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, but I find no rest. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the one Israel praises. In you, our ancestors put their trust. They trusted and you delivered them. To you, they cried out and were saved. In you, they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by everyone, despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Yet you brought me out of the womb. You made me trust in you. Even at my mother's breast, from birth I was cast on you. From my mother's womb you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls surround me. Strong bulls of Bashan encircle me. Roaring lions that tear their prey open, their mouths wide against me. I am poured out like water. And all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It has melted within me. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd. And my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs surround me. A pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and my feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. But you, Lord, do not be far from me. You are my strength. Come quickly to help me. Deliver me from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. Rescue me from the mouth of the lions. Save me from the horns of the wild oxen. I will declare your name to my people. In the assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him, revere him. All you descendants of Israel, for he has not despised or scorned the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. From you comes the theme of my praise in the great assembly. Before those who fear you, I will fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. All who go down to the dust will kneel before him. Those who cannot keep themselves alive, posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to the people yet unborn, he has done it. Did y'all notice? That was a roller coaster of things, wasn't it? David starts off by talking about how hard things are. And he throws in this line, the one that we quote, you inhabit the praises of Israel. And then he goes through and he talks about all these hard things that people are after him. He feels like he's attacked. He feels like his heart is melted. He says all these things, right? And then how does he end it? By saying that regardless of all that, he will praise the Lord. Regardless of what he's going through, he will praise the Lord. He literally ends it by saying, we will proclaim to those unborn, he has done it. You with me? So here's the question. How do I choose to allow him to be the king in my life? I praise him no matter what I'm going through. I put him first no matter what I'm going through. I exalt him no matter what I'm going through. I magnify him no matter what I'm going through. Last week, I told you guys in our Easter service, which was a weird service, I know, but I told you that it's okay to be honest. David is honest. He says all the things that are going on that are difficult, doesn't he? He's very clear about those things. But how does he end talking about this particular topic? By saying, God, you got this. I know who my God is. I know I can trust in you. I know that you will deliver me. I know that you've got this. I know that you've got me. Are you with me? This is what he chooses to do in the middle of his anguish, and that praise allows God to come in, to live in that praise, to be enthroned on that praise, and have authority in David's life to actually deliver David. It ain't got nothing to do with the fact that David was chosen, because David was chosen. But we've seen in our world people who God called, people who God selected, people who God elected and put into positions who failed. And there was no restoration. And there was, like, there's just the end of the story for that person in this world. So it has nothing to do with the fact that David, because, well, God had a call on David's life. He's got a call on your life. But you can waste it. You can throw it away. You can, instead of getting through that thing, you can allow it to kill you. And sometimes we like to do that. Sometimes that's who we choose to be. Because as I was getting this scripture ready this week, as I was preparing, God told me something that was interesting. We quote, he inhabits the praises of his people. He is enthroned upon the praises of his people. And this is what God told me. Whatever you praise will inhabit your life. Whatever you praise has the authority in your life. Okay. Well, I'll just praise God then. Okay, but what about when you don't? What are some other things that we praise in our life? How about sickness? Oh, I don't praise sickness. Really? You don't talk about it all the time? You don't magnify it in your life? You don't constantly go around telling everyone about that illness, about that sickness, about that disease, about what you're struggling with? That's not what you're constantly talking about? Again, David talks about the problem, but how does he end it? My God is well able. He doesn't ignore the fact that there is a problem, but that isn't the focus. His focus is, my God is well able. What do you praise? Because for all too many of us, we will go around and talk about how bad that sickness is, that ailment is. We'll talk about it all the time. And I've literally had conversations with people, Christian people, who will tell me that they're not doing well. And my response is, okay, I'll pray for you, or you know God's a healer. And their comment back to me is, we'll see. Okay. Just keep glorifying that sickness then. Just keep exalting that sickness then. If that's what you want to do, if you want to praise that thing, it will continue to inhabit your life. Or you can choose to praise, glorify, magnify, exalt the name of Jesus, and every name is under that name.
That's right.
Whatever sickness it is, it's under the name of Jesus. Whatever it is, it doesn't matter, it's under the name of Jesus. Are you with me? Y'all don't like it, but you're with me. All right, how about this one? What about fear, anxiety, depression? Again, I don't praise those things, really. Because that's always your default. Why can't you do that? Well, I just have anxiety too bad. Continue to glorify that thing. Continue to exalt that thing. I can't stand up for God the way he wants me to. I'm afraid of what people might think. Continue to exalt that thing. Continue to lift that thing up. Continue to allow that thing to rule in your life. I just can't function today. Guys, I'm not telling you that none of this stuff is real. I'm not telling you the sickness isn't real. It exists. I'm not telling you that fear isn't real. It exists. I'm not telling you anxiety isn't real. It exists. I'm not telling you depression isn't real. It exists. I've struggled with these things. What I am telling you is, whatever you choose to exalt will have dominion in your life. Whatever you choose to praise will have dominion in your life. I can't do that thing. I can't function. I can't get out of bed today. I'm depressed. Continue to exalt that thing. Continue to make it your center. Continue to make it your focus. And it will have dominion in your life. Boy, y'all quiet. All right. I got a list. But judging on how it's gone so far. Sin. Continue to praise it. Continue to magnify it. I keep making mistakes. Well, my focus is on that mistake. My focus is on that failure. I can't get past that thing. That thing that comes between me and God. Keep exalting it. And it will rule your life. That isn't where my attention belongs. Addiction. The more I lean into my addiction, the more I focus on my addiction, the more I think about my addiction, it's going to rule my life. It's going to have dominion in my life. It's going to have power and authority in my life because it is the thing I talk about all the time. Every time that we have a conversation, every time that me and somebody are talking about it, people are like, hey, you know, hey, I know you're struggling. Yeah, I'm struggling, but my God is well able. Amen. That my struggle is not the focus. My God is my focus. Do y'all understand? Yep. I know y'all are mad at me, and I get it, and that's fine. It's okay. But it's true. Continue to focus on sin. Continue to focus on things that pull you away from God. Continue to focus on that addiction. Continue to talk about it. Continue to talk it up. Continue to make it the center. Continue to do those things, and it will rule your life. Again, none of you are stupid. I don't believe that there's a single stupid person in here. But just because you're not stupid doesn't mean you don't make stupid decisions. Be real with yourself for a second and say, what am I struggling with? Maybe I haven't gotten to yours yet. I got a few more. Maybe I haven't gotten to yours yet. What are you struggling with? Quit focusing on it. Quit talking about it. Quit putting it at the center of your life. Quit giving it authority in your world. Instead, praise the name of Jesus. Instead, praise him that he matters more, that he is well able, whatever it is for you. Because what about your enemies? Well, I'm sure no one in here has any enemies. You're all on the best terms with everybody. You never butt heads with anybody. That's great. But for maybe someone watching online, you've got an enemy. That's all you do is talk about them. If it wasn't for them, things would be better. Maybe it's someone at your work. Maybe it's a family member. If they would just leave me alone, if they just wouldn't come against me, if they just wouldn't talk about me, if they'd keep their mouth shut, if they this, if they that, and all you're doing is giving them power over you. That's all you're doing. That's all you're doing. You're just continuously giving them power in your life. And then you wonder why you can't sleep at night, why you never feel rested, why everything in life is just kind of dull. There's no joy, there's no fulfillment. Because God is the one that brings those things. When he inhabits your praise, you know what you're getting because his Bible tells me what I get when he arrives. But I'm miserable in life. That's because he ain't there. That's because he don't live there. Man, y'all quiet. Okay. All right, so enemies. How about drama? Just drama for drama's sake. Just got to have something to say. Got to find a reason to put it out there. I tied this one in with also opinions. Guess what? Your opinion doesn't matter. This matters. His word matters. But nothing else matters outside of this. If your opinions are ruling your life, where every time someone says something, you feel like you need to post, or you need to have a rebuttal, or you need to say, and you need to tell them how wrong they are, that's just drama, that's just your opinion, and all that you are doing is putting that at the center of your life. And I can tell you this, you're not going to live a very peaceful life. You know why? Because of the 8 billion people that exist on this planet, you are the only one with all your opinions. Even if you find somebody who agrees with you on 99.99% of what you think, something you will disagree on. You'll find something, especially if you're both dramatic people. Eventually, you won't get down to it, and then that'll cause a rift. The reality of the situation is that the more that I allow my opinions to dominate my life and have dominion in my life, there won't be peace in my life. Because I'm always going to be looking for someone to tell how they're wrong and why I'm right. So let drama continue to rule your life. Keep giving it the power. Keep praising it. Keep talking about it. Keep giving credence to your opinion. Keep talking to everybody about how awesome your opinions are. See how isolated you can make yourself. Boy, y'all quiet. All Boo's over here. He likes it. What do you struggle with? All right. How about, last one, how about just the things you enjoy in life? Just your pastimes, the activities that you do. Why is that bad? It's not that you can't do them. It's just that they shouldn't be your focus. God created this world and then gave it to man for man's enjoyment, for man's pleasure. We should be able to enjoy things that exist that are good things. Ain't nothing wrong with those things. I like golf. I really enjoy playing golf. There's nothing wrong with me going and playing golf, other than my golf game's not very good. But outside of that, there's nothing wrong with me going and playing. But when I'm with people, if all I talk about is golf, 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 then that thing has dominion over me. That thing rules over me. Which means what? Which means that I am not doing the things that he created me to do. I'm choosing to do what I want to do. Again, there's nothing wrong with you enjoying things. When God gave me this one for the list, I was like, God, but I don't understand. All these other things are like clearly not good things. But this one, and he said, too many of my people have crowned king thing in their life. It's not bad. It's not a sin. It's not going to send them to hell. But the thing that matters most to them, the thing that inhabits their time, the things that the thing that is enthroned in their life is something that they want, something that they like, something that, and that's the thing they talk about all the time. Why is it so important for him to be enthroned in my life? Why is it so important for him to inhabit my life? I'm going to tell you why. Because the thing that is at the center of my life, the thing that is enthroned in my life, the thing that is that inhabits my life is the thing I'll talk about. You ever want to get to know someone? Hang out with them for a while. Listen to what they talk about. You'll get to know them quick. People like talking about things that they like, things that are important to them. Whatever is enthroned in my life, whatever inhabits my life is the thing that I will spend time talking about. So why this list? Why can't I have those things enthroned in my life? Because then that's all I talk about. And then it's a vicious cycle, because the more I talk about it, the more it's the center of my life. The more it's the center of my life, the more I'll talk about it. Why is it so important to enthrone him in my life? Because A, whenever he arrives, he brings stuff. We talked about this. Whenever he arrives, he is the answer to the questions that I have. He helps me solve the problems that are going on. He is the only reason that I am able to do the things I'm able to do. I need him in my life. Yep. But also, I need to talk about him. You know why? Because I'm not the only one that needs him. You do too. Your friends need him. Your family needs him. That coworker desperately needs him. When he is enthroned in my life, then I will talk about him. Then I will spread his name. Because now, when I am going through a hard thing, someone sees that I'm going through a difficult time. And they come to me, and they go, oh my goodness, this horrible thing that's going on. And your response is, yeah, this is not good. We got a report from the doctor. The doctor says all these things. But you know what? My God is the healer. My God is well able to take care of this for me. I trust my God. I proclaim even now that he will do it. And people will look at you and they will go, well, that's stupid. That's okay if they think that. You know why? Because that's their opinion and not your opinion. And they're entitled to their opinion. Just like you're entitled to your opinion. But I'm not making my opinion the center of my life. I'm making the fact the center of my life. And the fact is, my God is a healer. That's a fact. It's not an opinion. I've seen him heal. I know he can. I know he will. Whatever it is I'm going through, it's not that I have to ignore what I'm going through. It's that I have to praise him in spite of it. I have to praise him in the middle of it, because when I do, I am giving him authority in my life. Do y'all understand? This is what life is. This is what it is to be a child of God. You have access to something. See, there are people who don't know this truth. Maybe before now you didn't know this truth, but now you do. That's great. But there are people who don't know this truth, so what's going to happen is you're going to come up against people who are struggling with things, and they're going to talk to you, and they're going to say, man, I'm just really battling this thing. This I really want to quit smoking, but I just can't. This thing I'm addicted to, I wish I didn't do this, but this is the thing I do. I'm not saying smoking will send you to hell. I'm just saying these might be a conversation you have with someone. Smoking, I just want to quit that. Yeah, quit talking about that addiction and talk about the fact that you're set free in Jesus' name. Amen. The Word of God says that whom the Son sets free is free indeed. He died for your freedom. You don't have to be addicted to that. You don't have to keep doing that thing. The more that I praise him and he becomes the center in my life, enthroned in my life, I give him authority in my life, now I will talk about who he is in my life, what he's done in my life. And when I see other people who are struggling with things, I will tell them what he is capable of. Oh, I couldn't possibly do that. I couldn't possibly tell people that. What if they think I'm weird? Okay, well, just keep hoisting fear up in the center of your life. Keep putting it on the forefront of your life. Keep making it the center of your life. But if you make Jesus the center of your life, then there will be nothing that will hold you back from talking about him. You know why? Because there will be nothing more important to you than that. Do you understand that there are actual people in this world that have lived in this world who have actually been killed for Jesus? That's been a real thing that happened to real people, beaten, stoned, crucified, beheaded. John was literally boiled in oil. Real people sacrificed for Jesus, but you're afraid of what someone might say? You're afraid of a look they might give you? You're afraid that maybe if you start talking about Jesus, they'll think you're weird and not want to be your friend anymore? Oh, man. Where's your priorities? What do you praise? What do you exalt? What's enthroned in your life? What's the most important thing to you? I'm not saying any of this. I mean, like, I haven't always lived this way, but I do now. To the best of my ability, I talk about him all the time. Whenever I'm going through hard things, I praise him. When my wife brings things up at the house and she's worried or nervous about something, my answer is Jesus. And sometimes she doesn't know how to feel about that, because in that moment, there's concern, there's worry. But I reassure her that Jesus. Sometimes I'm worried and she reassures me that Jesus. And we continue to sharpen each other, and we continue to work with each other to grow. And maybe you're not at a place where you have that. Maybe you're not at a place. I will give you my number. If you don't want to call me, get someone else in here's number and allow yourself to be sharpened with other believers. Grow alongside other believers. Be challenged with other believers and by other believers to constantly put Jesus first. Because the more that I put him first, the better my life will be. I may not have all the things that I think I need or I think I want, but I will ultimately have the only thing that I truly need. Forever. Because he's not going anywhere. Amen? All right. Y'all still mad? All right. Y'all can stand. I want y'all to understand, praising him, truly praising him for who he is, it is optional. It is optional. You can make that decision to not do it. You can make that decision to say, I'm not going to praise him. Instead, I'm going to glorify, magnify, talk about, I'm going to build up this thing that's going on in my life. You can choose to do it. But understand that when you're struggling, when you're truly up against things, and when you're at home and you're like, I don't know why I can't get past this thing, ask yourself, what am I glorifying? What am I praising? What am I giving all my attention to? What am I giving all of my thoughts, my words, what am I giving it all to? What truly has my heart? What truly has my focus? What truly has my attention? So often, it's like we put blinders on to what's really going on. And again, none of you are stupid. Not a single person in here. You're all well able to identify that thing. So right now, as we take a moment to pray, just think about it. Don't work to hide it, because I'm not asking you to call it out to me. Call it out to him. Tell him. He already knows. Why do I have to tell him? Because he wants to know that you see it, that you recognize it, that you can identify what that problem is, so that you can give it to him. See, when I enthrone him in my life, when I give him power, when I give him authority, I take all of those things, the things that we just talked about, all the struggles, and I say, I don't choose to put them on the throne anymore. Jesus, I put you on the throne. I can't handle these. I give them to you. I put them under your authority. That's what you can choose to do. I put them under your authority. That thing that I can't deal with, that thing I'm addicted to, that feeling that I have, that feeling of anger, that feeling of anxiety, that feeling of depression, that feeling of whatever it is, I give it to you. I surrender it to you. What happens when it pops its head back up throughout my week? That thing happens. I see it. I don't deny it, but I also don't embrace it. Yep, there it is again. God, you are greater than that thing. God, you are greater than that temptation. God, you are greater than that emotion. God, you are greater than the way that I feel about that person. God, you are, continue to proclaim who he is. Not how good that thing is, not how big that thing is, not how hard that thing is, no. How big your God is. How awesome your God is. How mighty your God is. How loving your God is. How generous your God is. How peaceful your God is. How joyful your God is. That's what you continue to declare. And as you do that, he comes in. He inhabits that place. He's enthroned in that place. And he comes in with the ability to actually change things for you. It's all about what you focus on. I was having a conversation this morning where literally that was said. It's all about what you focus on. And now he probably knows why I was laughing when he said it. It's all about what you focus on. So Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, in this moment, God, I stand before you exposed, because God, I know for me, throughout this service, I know the things that I've been putting on the throne of my life that are not you. I know things that I have chosen to praise and exalt and magnify and talk about so much that they have literally become the center of my world. And those things aren't you. So, Father, in this moment right now, I repent for putting anything else on the throne of my life that isn't you. You are King Jesus. You are Lord of Lords, King of Kings. There is none beside you. So God, I am sorry for the times that I have exalted anything else above you. I apologize, and I am sorry for the times that I have made anything else more important to me than you. That I have even played a comparison game, because there is no comparison. So I ask for forgiveness. God, that thing that's in my life, I don't want that thing to have any control or dominion in my life for another moment. I don't want to live one more day with that thing hanging over my head. I don't want to go another step holding this thing, having this thing have power in my life. So God, right now, I choose to praise you. I choose to worship you. I choose to honor you as God. I choose to put you in your rightful place in my heart. I choose to put you in your rightful place in my life. I choose to be obedient to the things that you say. I choose to show you love and affection the way that I should. I choose to lean into who you are and the things that you are able to do in my life more than I lean into the power of that thing in my life. And as I begin to enthrone you in my life, not only do I give you dominion and power over me, but I give you dominion and power over that thing. That thing that makes me sick, that thing that breaks my heart, that thing that I don't want anymore, I can't stand it. I give you power over it. I give you power over me.
God, help me as I move forward, that I don't take that power away from you, but that I'm reminded of how much my praise matters. That I'm reminded that every single time that I begin to praise, whatever I praise is exalted in my life. Whatever I praise has authority in my life. So God, in those times, moving forward from this moment right now, when I come up against things, help me to praise your name. Help me to praise you for who you are. Help me to give you glory and honor. God, help me to exalt you. Remind me of the importance of my praise, the power in my praise, so that I will choose you over everything else. And then God, as you become the penultimate in my life, help me to proclaim that. Help that just to begin to seep out of me on every occasion with everyone I'm with, that your goodness and your mercy that is running after me, it's also running after that person. It's also running after that friend. It's also running after that family member, that coworker, that boss, that employee, that it's running after every other person. Help me to bring your goodness and mercy into their lives. Help me to be a display of that goodness and mercy for them. To be the witness you've called me to be the person you've called me to be who you've created me to be. I thank you. I praise you, Father God. I am so in love with you. Jesus, thank you for all that you have done for me, all the sacrifices that you made for me, that you continue to do so much for me. I am in awe of you. I literally stand in awe of you. Be with your people. As they go throughout this week, bring back to their remembrance the things we talked about. Help them to be able to make better choices. Help them to be able to lean into you and focus on you and praise you over all of those other things, to put you in your rightful place. Thank you. We praise you. We love you. We glorify you and magnify you, King Jesus. For there is none like you. Bless your people. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen.